Good, and I can advance with that. As an introduction, let me tell you what the interests are that have motivated this type of work. I'm interested in, I'll try to stand there and see if I need to sit. I'm interested in ancient monuments and specifically on how these monuments respond to seismic activation, to earthquakes. The problem here is the following. The material is brittle, so the material cannot be modeled with standard linear models, has to be modeled with highly nonlinear behavior. And at the same time, you have complexities in terms of finding material parameters. You end up constructing fairly large models and so forth. So the goal here is how to come up with highly simplified model that still give a viable solution for the problem. And I'll do my presentation by using two examples. One is the Frigidarium of the Baths of Diocletian in Rome, and the other one Peru will be an adobe church built in the early Spanish domination of Peru. So what is the goal here? What I want to do, instead of using standard finite element analysis, I want to use another approach, which is based on the notion that due to the action of the earthquake, fracture will propagate to the solid will be decomposed in a series of blocks. These blocks will be hinged, one with respect to the other. So I'm seeking to find instability condition that will determine the collapse of the structure. That condition essentially will give me the highest earthquake that the structure can sustain. This is an approach that has been taken for other monuments. There is some sophisticated points here that bring back not just the behavior of solids, but also the resistance of the solid. The contribution is also, in the specific case of the Frigidarium, towards understanding certain aspects of Roman engineering design. We are looking at some of the most spectacular vaulted system. In fact, the Frigidarium is the second largest vaulted concrete, unreinforced concrete building built in by Roman engineers. The dimensions are 63 meters long, 24 meters wide, and approximately 30 meters high. The material, and you can see some examples, let me see if I have a pointer here. The material is, no.
It
the red dot at the top. Okay, so I've gone into somewhere else. Let me see if I can get back into the presentation. No, yeah. And I'm back there. In any case, the material is shown over here. It's an artificial material, is essentially the choice material for these large vaulted structures. The Frigidarium is particularly interesting because in structural, it's in excellent structural conditions. Just to give an idea, it was essentially abandoned for 1,000 years. There was no type of maintenance done, and the structure is, from the point of view of the vaulted structure, is essentially in mint condition. So there is no fracturing, there is nothing that indicates problems. If you compare that with the baths of Caracalla, the major vault has collapsed. So the interest here is really to understand what specifically was done in the architecture of the structure to ensure this resistance. The mechanics of collapse for this type of structure, as I was alluding to before, depends very much on the nature of the material. The material is brittle, so with relatively small stresses in tension, the material will fracture, which essentially means from a mechanical point of view that whereas initially you had a continuum, now you have a series of blocks. And you can see the developing of the deformation due to the application of simple gravitational loads, the formation of the fractures and the hinges. And then when you have the application of a lateral acceleration due to an earthquake, then you have collapse. The specific interest in this architectural, in the structural organization that was introduced in Roman times very early and then continued essentially up to the 1800s is that in order to resist the lateral forces and lateral accelerations in this particular case, you have the presence of shear walls on the side. And then an analysis proves quite clearly that the shear walls have a fundamental make a fundamental contribution on the resistance of these structures. The point here is that how do you analyze the resistance of the entire structure? How do you define the limit state, the condition of collapse? You can do it with finite element analysis, as it should be clear from previous presentation. Doing the finite element analysis of this type of structure is quite demanding, in part for the geometry, but primarily because of the complexity of modeling the nonlinear behavior of the material. So essentially, this reduces to the fact that you can do finite element analysis up to a certain point, taking advantage of the little that you know about the material, using relatively simple meshes, and confronted with the problem that when the analysis stops, you really do not know whether you have a collapsed condition or you have found a numerical problem that stops the analysis. So essentially, you reach a point at which you may assume that there is a collapse, but you really do not know whether you have gone there simply because of numerical problems in the formulation, or you are actually there because of the physical condition. So the alternative procedure is based on a very simple consideration that I'm illustrating here using a simple block. The block is supported at A and hinged at B. The block is carried by a roller that is accelerating towards the left. Because of inertia, there are forces that develop in the opposite direction. They are applied at the centroid of the block. Depending upon the acceleration of the supporting structure that simulates the acceleration due to an earthquake, these inertial forces will combine with produce a rotation, and numerically you can determine the value of the acceleration that will bring about the collapse. So this is the idea that is at the basis of the modeling. The next step is how to go from a continuum structure to actually structure made in blocks. A suggestion comes from doing an initial nonlinear finite element analysis in which you can see by using a particular formulation. In this case, you simulate the fracturing behavior by using pseudoplasticity, which is available in standard finite element codes, but it's not easy to apply. But you can determine the areas where fractures will develop. Based on that, you can break down your solid into blocks. So at this point, the problem becomes finding numerically the acceleration that that brings about the collapse. In the case of the frigidarium, we are using a three-dimensional model. You can see the finite element analysis, which was stopped before we reached the final condition, because we didn't know whether the conditions were numerical collapse or real collapse. And then to the right, you can see the division in blocks with the repositioning of the hinges. All this was done using a standard tool, very much using mechanical engineering. It's a very comprehensive tool developed by Siemens that has solid modeling and kinematics. And what you're seeing here is actually the simulation on the actual 3D model representing a section of the frigidarium. You can see the articulation of the fractures, and unfortunately on the PC it doesn't loop, on the Mac it will loop, but what you can see is the position of the fractures and the final collapse. What is quite interesting in here is the fact that even though you are now working with blocks, you still have to take into account that the material you are using has only a limited capability of resisting not just tension but also compression. What does it mean? In this condition of rotations, you have that very large compressive forces are going to be acting on the system. They bring about additional problem, additional crushing of the material. And so you have to take into account this in relocating the position of the hinges. And in fact, if you look at the analysis, without repositioning the hinges, in other words, not taking into account the strength of the material, you have that the acceleration of 0.413G is needed to demolish the structure. This is an extremely high earthquake. If you go instead by introducing the strength in compression, it lowers down to 0.266. The finite element analysis stops at 0.2. And this clearly shows that in doing this type of analysis, even using a simplified model, you need to have a clear understanding of the material properties. So the question always comes back to the fact that somehow you have to measure the material properties to measure the resistance in compression and tension. How do you do that with a monumental structure, heritage structure like this? You cannot go inside and cut a piece because you will be killed instantly by the authorities. So what you do in many cases, you reproduce artificially, you recreate the material in laboratory and you do a number of experiments. So there is a degree of uncertainty. You remain with the structure. Jumping into Peru, very early Spanish church, totally built in adobe. It's particularly interesting because of the thickness of the walls. These are 2 meters thick walls. And if we were to discuss the architecture over here, you would see that this is a combination of European architecture, European technology, built by Inca workers and introducing even elements of Islamic architecture, especially in the roofing system. The problem here is that you have a highly seismic area, especially along the coast of Peru, but also reaching in at the level of Cusco. So you need to really understand how the structure will respond to an earthquake. You do this again, or either by using finite element analysis or by going into some simplified model. I'm showing you two examples here of application of finite elements. In this case, is a very, very expensive application. Three-dimensional model. The model had to be simplified, otherwise, literally, it would take weeks to run the model. But it shows very clearly that if we apply a uniform an increasing acceleration on one side, we can reproduce the damage. More interesting is the dynamic simulation in which you can actually subject the structure to an earthquake signal. So you have the ground acceleration, you apply that. In order to compute this highly simplified model, we had 2 weeks of calculation on a supercomputer using 48 CPUs working in parallel. So what you end up doing, you work on simplified, you work on structural elements. In this particular case, we are working with the triumphal arch. And what we are doing, I'll go very fast over this. I'll use a finite element formulation that allows me, it's highly nonlinear, but allows me to measure the energy that goes into the structure. What is the importance of that? Because if I can measure the energy, and this is the example of the analysis running, I can detect very clearly whether the failure is happening for a numerical problem or because the energy is being converted. Before collapse, the energy is stored elastically into the structure. At collapse, the energy becomes dynamic. So I have the possibility in this case of tracing the entire collapse due to the horizontal acceleration due to the earthquake. And in fact, if I plot the energy, I can see very precisely the point at which this model shows the transition between being static in the transition to collapse, which is a dynamic condition. How do I use this information? I can evaluate how different architecture control the lateral resistance, the resistance to a seismic action laterally, by using first a very simple geometry like this, and I have a very low resistance at this level here, and then I add the different architectural elements. And you can see that the solution at the top, the solution that produces the highest resistance up to more than half G, so resisting even the strongest earthquake that has been measured in this area, it's again produced by using the same solution produced designed by Roman architects. So finally, and summarizing not only what has been what I have done over here, but much that has been said during the various presentations, finite element models do indeed provide a critical insight for the evaluation for the evaluation of the resistance of the structure and providing information for the conservation. They also can provide an insight into the historical development. By looking at the evolution of these structures, we can really understand how the knowledge was acquired, how errors, total collapses or partial collapses contributed to the development of this knowledge. But at the end of the game, the real challenge, it still remains in determining how the material can be represented mechanically. What is quite interesting is that whereas civil engineering today is totally based on reinforced concrete and steel structure, in dealing with the structures, we are dealing with quasi-brittle materials. From a numerical point of view, this is one of the most challenging aspects because of the highly non-linearity of the behavior, because of the fact that there is different type of energies. When fractures develop, you have a dissipation of energy. All these represented in standard engineering codes is tremendously challenging. And with this, I'm done. Thank you very much.